said to him, but he answered their accusations about him. He answered their accusations about him. That's really important. And the question becomes, how do we answer the accusations against us? How do we answer in a way that is an answer? Anybody? It's about something, somebody said it is an answer, but something that works, something that is an answer, not just a retort back to something, but an answer. He answered, he that paid me well, the same also said, pick up my dead one. just has scattered throughout here. There's a little big section of chapter 9 where chapter 9 man blind now sees. He's having a real hard time listening to the parents. This guy had walked for 30 years. He's having just a real hard time. Get the real picture out of this one when we do chapter 9. But here he simply, he answers them, he that may be willing, the same son that we take up thy bed and walk. Then ask they, now what man is that who said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? So he has successfully taken the emphasis off of him and put it on the Lord. Now I ask you, how do you deal with accusation? In reality, you must successfully take the accusation from Peter and place it on the Lord. The trick to doing that is that it has to be the Lord. You can't just be blaming God. We have to obey His word, we have to follow. Doing, we receive accusation or whatever. Then, we'll see this with Jesus very quickly. Then you can successfully, when I say successfully, I don't mean to necessarily convince them. I mean in a way in you that makes it right. So you are not bearing junk, the devil's not getting in, your mind isn't playing games, but guilt isn't. Doing things to you, but you have successfully dealt with it, and you don't, you're not all wrapped up. Most of you know what that's like. You're all wrapped up in some sort of confrontation, guilt kind of deal. There's only one real successful way. When I said this man was alluding to Jesus, that's found the answer. Is it? So what man is he? What man that said? And he said, and he that was healed knew not who he was, but Jesus had moved away a multitude of people. You know, isn't that interesting? The other guy in chapter 9 was healed. You know, I mean, we think the whole deal is, I mean, I'll never forget one time. But what a building, yeah. One time I came out of the church, several years over there where we're at now, came out of the church and then somebody had a flat tire on the street. So I went over there and that vehicle was in hell. Apparently he didn't know how to change the flat. So I got down there. Just want you to know that I didn't do all of this because I'm a nice guy, but because I'm a Christian and I love Jesus Christ. And I wouldn't have thought that would have been interesting. You would have witnessed that you knew this. I mean, I felt real good about it. I didn't like eating over the head of Jesus while I was sick. I felt that I had really handled it real well. But the Lord dealt with me after that. He told me that, you know, you don't always even have to set Jesus, the name Jesus, for it to be, or for it to even be successful. Now, I don't know if we understand that, but this man said that Jesus, according to whoever Jesus was even another man. This guy, whoever he was who said unto me, pick up the ball. And he said, who is this guy? He said, I don't know. I don't know. And Now, that doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. I mean, our whole thing is witness. But once again, I really have a hard time to understand witness, because I believe to be a witness, you have to personally be an eyewitness. You have to know, you have to see the world, you have to really, really a single witness. So, and a witness has something to say. Sometimes they have to see this car wreck and all this stuff, and I'm going to go back and I think this and that. You know, a lot of policemen are reporting on stuff, so did you see what happened? I say, yeah, what happened? Well, a witness has something to say. It's somebody who's not a witness. But that doesn't make sense. So, to me, it's not even so much that we, although, obviously, we can learn to go to a lot of different places. We share, we hand out tracts, we talk to people about Jesus. We have the sons of ours that hand out tracts to the foundations to make them. And, you know, we do that. But I wonder what our motivation is in every time we have to say something. What I'm getting at is this. Can sometimes it just be Jesus without having to make a big deal about it? Apparently for him, sometimes it's just realizing it's not great for us. He didn't do it alone. Oh, this is going to be a big witness to the people out here. I think maybe he just did it because he's that way. It is interesting in this case, and also in the case of the man in John chapter 9. Now, I like this, because this guy's laying there, and I mean, he is totally unable to get in, really help to get anything. Jesus comes up and initiates, ministers to him. And then later on, it says, verse 14, afterwards, Jesus finds him. We're always trying to get hold of God. And I believe that's good. I believe it's good to have a heart after God. But I do want you to know that every given moment of every day, of every hour, your heart isn't necessarily going to be after the Lord. He's something else. He finds you. It says this, verse 16, and therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him. Now, this is pretty tough to imagine. Help somebody who's been a car and walked for 38 years. That's not tough to imagine. Do you know that you have Jesus? Sometimes reactions toward you, loved ones, friends, or whatever, may seem to overreact. And you may not always understand why, but sometimes it is an overreaction. Sometimes it's an overreaction. It's not all the time. Sometimes you feel things coming. Take life or whatever. Sometimes people react to because, you know, in their mind, they're going, oh, not helping, not because you help someone, because you told them to pick up the stick, like you said. Now, what do you notice in progression of this thing goes to the church? They persecuted Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath. In other words, if it wasn't on your calendar there, if it wasn't on this particular day here, if you had just moved it over one day on the calendar, it probably would have been, you know, written up on the front page of the newspaper. That's a good deal. But it's over a slot, so that makes it bad. Their words are their investing here. Is that what you're saying? That wasn't hard. That wasn't what you were saying. That wasn't the principle. That wasn't the action based on the principle. That was what they saw according to either what they would have done or what they've done many times or what they would have said that somebody else would do. So Jesus, seeing that they're seeking reward of him and are very upset with him, wants to explain. All right, then answered Jesus and said, Verily, I say unto you, and he uses those words. I mean, if you can translate it, and I'll probably translate it truly, that's always amazing. When I found that out, like 22 years of the Lord, I was amazed that the Son of God had to say, truly, or please believe me, or, you know what I mean? I mean, I found that amazing that he would have to preface anything he said and that his words not honored about people the way it should be. Words not honored as it should be. Therefore, he has to say, tell them the truth in order to get entrance. Truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself. But what he seeth the Father do, he said the Son can do nothing. And he's using the words nothing, not everything. Oh, he didn't say the Son can do exactly what his Father can do, because the Son and the Father are one, and we're both in the Godhead, and I can do whatever I want to, and he can do it too, because we're both God. He didn't say that at all. Now, we might say that, and we might translate the concept of the Trinity into 3 in 1, equal in all ways, and whatever. And I would say, I wouldn't have any problem with that, because there is one God, 3 distinct ways of manifesting. And I believe they are equal in all ways because they are one. But when you're one of them, you're not equal with the other two. You may not understand that. You are, but not here. Did you catch what I said? No. Shocked and woke up. Yes. When you're one of them, you're not equal with the rest of them. You're less than the rest of them in your mind. And this is where you get Jesus saying, okay, I didn't come down here to be with me. I came to lift up the Father. You get the Holy Spirit saying, hey, I'm not the one. I came here just to lift up Jesus. It is within their nature, or the nature that is them. Not anything like what we are. Anyway, their being is sold down to the rest. And they are secure in that because the being of the rest are sold out. Talk to him or whatever, you know, or if I just trying to lay out the way it is, because if they see it, if somehow they see it, then they'll know the doctrine. But if they don't see it, there's no hope for it. He doesn't just take on an attitude of, oh, you don't see it. You know, that's because you're on a job meeting. You know, you're not just going to do yourself. I believe that, well, first of all, not the principle, but the way it works in him is going to make him want to lift up the Father, period. So he's going to just, if nothing else, he's going to want to work by the principle, which would be to lift up the Father, please. And that's what's working in him. He's not even thinking in terms of, I'm lesser, I'm no value, or I'm not important. I don't believe he's thinking that. See, he doesn't have a poor self-image. This isn't an image problem. This is a tremendous desire to lift up the Father or another that is within the scope of this being that is called God, which, by the way, we were added to. We've been added to, that's true. But I know I'm talking about the scope of this. God. It is to lift up the Father and to have him glorified. And he's not doing that because, now get this. See, we lift up the Father because he's greater than us, he's better than us, he's kinder than us, he has more love than us, he in every way is better than us, so my God, we ought to lift him up. I don't believe that's what should be working in Christians. I really don't. Now, I believe there is a certain amount. We are his creation also. Now, I believe God's trying to relate to us as sons, not creatures. Children of the family. Son, father. I think that's what is really important. And I don't think there's anything wrong with us acknowledging the creator and acknowledging the goodness of this God on that level. But I certainly don't think that's primarily what was working with Jesus, nor should be working with Christians. I think that what primarily working with Jesus has nothing to do. You see what I mean? How could you explain this? I mean, I'm kind of, you see, we do all that because we go, oh, you're so great, I'm so bad, you're so good, I'm so young, you're so wonderful, and I'm a real Greek. You know what I mean? I mean, we're doing all this comparing, and Jesus isn't comparing because, in reality, he's got the same authority, he's got the same power, he's got the same nature, he's got, I mean, in every way, he is equal with God. But they said, you're making yourself equal. Now, that's where you got a problem. No, that couldn't even be. Now, if you were to make me equal with him, see Jesus saying that. You want to acknowledge me as equal with the Father, as part of the Godhead and everything, that's fine. If you want to glorify me as such, fine. But I'm not making myself equal. Not because I'm lesser, but because this other principle that's working in me is so down to self-giving or glorifying another. And if it involved, you're so great and I'm so yucky, then there's a certain degree, in fact, I would say a greater degree, of inward looking at self than outward looking at giving glory. Because you know how lucky you are, how yucky you are. You look at him, and he's so great, and you see how great he is, and the immediate result of that is, oh, well, you know, yucky, so you deserve the glory, so this yucky man gives you glory. All anyway, so what's the point of all of this anyway? But if that base is not inward, if it's not based on self-centered, I look at, I mean, my eyes really, I mean, they're not like on little bitty things, you know, protruding poles out here where I can look at myself all the time like this. God stuck not the situation. So, please just pray to the Father, 3 days later, the Father raises him from the dead. We need, you know, we need assurances, we need comparisons, we need to hear from God that you're okay. You know what God's always saying? I love you. Have you ever, anybody ever listened to any words ever given in church? Correct. I love you. I'm with you. I'm helping you. I'm always there for you. What else? He's all, that's that principle working. I mean, sooner or later, you're going to say, I'm totally sick of this. I'm sick of all of you. It's not even. We all sit in service after service going, you sick of us? Because we're looking at us. And he's not getting any glory. He's being taken down the circle. This is why I always saw it. Is that it was originally a critical circle. Father sent the Son, and the Son sent the back, and the Holy Spirit. They all glorified, you know, one another. All, I mean, like the Holy Spirit, their Son Jesus. Jesus gives them the Father. The Father sends the Holy Spirit. There's this never ending protection. If one gets in trouble, they don't have to take care of themselves. If that doesn't do it, well, it's just built in. And so what was added was we were added to this as the bride of Christ and as the church. And we were added to it and given this nature, which is Jesus. So really, in truth, we were joined with Jesus at one. But I'm going to help you to see it better. It's our part. I mean, by this receive we the love of God because he laid down his life. Folks, what says he laid down his life? It's this very critical part. He laid down his life for others. Not thinking about himself. For what? For others. And then it says, and we ought. Like any human, it's unlike any is his answer, and it will see him through this situation and the next and the next and the next, because he has assurances. Now, there's that on the here question, something that they don't like about, which I don't see so far. But, you know, there, this is the here question. And so they don't know. But he knows, and so he is. This is, you know, I mean, I don't think he's even trying to be instructional in a certain sense. I think he's just saying, well, this is it. This is the way I operate. And the whole key to this thing is Sabbath. Because there is a rest to be entered into in this relationship. There's a rest to be entered into. And that's what this whole section of this chapter is all about. It's how you enter the rest. What rest? Jesus is explaining that, as he says in verse 19. Then, Jesus answered Jesus and said unto them, "Very clearly I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do, but whatever things he doeth, these also the Son doeth in the same manner. For the Father loveth the Son, and showeth him all things that he himself doeth, and he will show him greater works than these, that he may marvel." Okay, and let's see. Verse 30. I can of my own self do nothing, as I hear I judge. My judgment is just because I seek not mine own will. He's not seeking his will. He's not in, he's in this with the Father. To glorify the Father. He's not trying to go, okay, this is, you guys are messing with me, I'm the Son of God, you mess with me, I'm messing with you. It's not that kind of a deal. He doesn't get all caught up. See, there's a million routes that he can take other than this. He can just say, "Who the heck do you think you are?" He can burn them out. He can justify. He can do any number of things, all of the things which we try to do in order to answer, if not the people, then our own mind. But he is totally secure because they're saying, here's the basis. This is the Sabbath. You don't do any work on the Sabbath. You did work on the Sabbath. And in the book of, what was it, Numbers or so on, when the first guy went out and gathered manna on the Sabbath, they killed him. You did work on the Sabbath. Guess what? We've been seeking, this has caused us to seek things to kill you. You should die. And Jesus stands over here and looks at him and he says, basically, it's the Sabbath. It's the Sabbath, and I didn't do it. You get it? That's his answer. You're right. It's the Sabbath, and I didn't do any work. Why? And he gets into this at a certain juncture. He goes, "Why would you have forgiven me, man?" Can you imagine the Son of God even speaking that way? But he does. It's almost those words. I mean, he goes, "Why do you have to kill me? You know, what is the deal here? Don't you understand?" No, you don't understand. If you understand, I mean, this is chapter 8 when he finally been dealing with it for quite a while. And he goes, "Yeah, you're of your father the devil. The works that he does, you're going to do. I am of my heavenly Father who gives himself, and I am of his seed, and I'm going to give myself. I didn't do it. I am a channel of him. And the words that you saw are his works. And the words that you heard are his words. And I'm, then what are you doing?" I'm resting. Got to finish everything 7 days, he rested, and that's it. Finished everything. rest to us is something primarily related to our flesh. But rest to God is primarily related to a union with Him by the grace by which now what comes forth out of you is no longer you. You have attitudes? Yes. They don't blossom out as a fruit. Just because you have a bird fly over your head doesn't mean you have to let it make a nest in your head, or in your hair. You have feelings, you have a soul, you have a body, you have all of those things Jesus had. Jesus experienced all of the attacks of the enemy. The enemy is not dumb. Jesus was man. Satan had a longer history in dealing with flesh and reactions and man and pulls and motivations and temptations. Years and years of that. Jesus had 30 short years of practice hidden away. Satan had been doing it for thousands. So we see Jesus out in the wilderness not eating. We see Satan come to him, and folks, it says those were temptations. If Jesus wasn't tempted by it, there wouldn't be a temptation. He felt the same pull you and I feel. We're also, I hate this. Well, you just don't understand. Because, well, in this situation, it's a crisis, and it needs to be the Lord. performance engineers, that I do, when you run this big crisis situation, all I want to do is Jesus, because I can see that if it's not, what it's going to end up, and it's going to end up bad for me. I want to be Jesus. Because I see the death. Whereas over here, if I shut that poison down, somebody will think they're dead. Or that they got the best of them. Or they got one up on me. Or that they can expect me to be their slave at every given moment. Or on. Every answer, every thought, you know, right down the line, that selfish, self-centered, I've got to protect me, I've got to build walls around me, and you're more Jericho than you are the people of God. Whereas Christ, man, and now, as I yesterday, he is the same. But remember, not far back. He is the same. He's in the same. He's in this situation. We see no. It doesn't start chapter 5 by saying, it starts this way. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, a feast went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem a sheep gate and pool, which is having many sick people in there, led a great multitude. It doesn't say, Jesus went to the feast, he saw the Pharisees and the Jews and the Magi's all in and around. So they walked into this situation and said, I don't know. Well, he was going to make a big deal out of it, and I'll show him. Which would have been being aware of him and how to protect himself and all that in that circumstance. But instead, walking. He ends up up there, and he ends up a little young people. He looks, he checks out, he sees this guy's been there a long time. He's probably older because he's been in this situation a long time. He might be ready to hear something because he's been there long enough to know he don't have the strength, he don't have the ability. And some of us may have to, you know, what should take 11 days or 2 years may take 40. And that's our business. Why do we do that? Because it is every This is why they came to him at different times, and they accused him and said, you did this on the Sabbath and you're bad. And he said, no, I didn't do it. And at other times they said, oh, Jesus, you're wonderful. Look what work you did. And he said, I didn't do it. You see the difference? He didn't take the adoration when he said, oh, you did the work. You know, I mean, it's easy when you're down out somewhere. You're dirty right here. It's just the Lord. And then if you truly walk by that principle, you won't be caught by this. But if you're caught by it, when you're not truly walking by it, you're just hurting. You're trying to find some weird weapon. And that is, then you're walking by and you're waiting for the man, thinking somebody comes up and goes, oh man, what a great work there. And everything, well, that's the Lord coming. And even if you don't outwardly feel a fool self, the attention of self, the fool, you caught it. Yeah. Instead of the automatic that is settled, because the principle is settled, because the day by day, moment by moment, is settled. The principle is settled. It's the way it is. Hey, look, I can tell you, it's old. Good thing you're on your toes. This was a good padding. We thought you were going to go with it. Good thing you were on your toes and didn't let that snake up on you. No, I wasn't on my toes. It was the Father. And every time when you said it was bad, it was still the Father. When you liked it a lot, it wasn't me. It was the Father. It doesn't really matter. I'm on my toes. There's too many different situations. I can't figure them all out. It's just one situation. It's going to be the Father in every situation. And when somebody comes and says, you bad guy, because it was, you know, we didn't like that. You say, man, I can't explain it. If you don't like it, I will go back because I don't want to hurt anybody else in the process. Father, was that you? And he says, that was me. Then all you can say is, man, if you're going to kill me for what the Father is kind of doing, but I want to be the Father, even if you hate me. And if they come and go, oh, that's a man, you go, hey, man. Well, how do you know that? Because you know that wasn't you. How do you not get sucked in? Because you know it wasn't you. You're not fooled. You're not sucked in. You know, it's the Father. It's the work of the Father. And because of his great love, Jesus said, he shows me all things. Well, because I'm perfect, I'm going just right. He keeps showing me stuff, and I keep helping out. That reaches the Father. Because, you know, he says, because the way the Father is in this love relationship, he shows me all things. And I do. But when we're selfish, we're going, oh, show me. Sooner on your lust, then he doesn't show you. Then you don't know why. Then you get upset. Then you don't know what to do. Then you take a selfish action in that situation. Then you blame God when you find out because it was selfish, and if he'd have showed you the right thing, you wouldn't have done it, but he didn't show you that you were asking for selfishness in the first place. And it just builds up, and pretty soon you build up a case against God. Because he won't come through for you. And at the very place when you get to that seething, he won't come through for me, is the great monumental testimony of the whole thing. But you never learned from it. That's why you understand. That's why you can't. Understand. Because he speaks these words within the realm of this. And we try to fit them within the realm of this. It's his word of the world. It's his spirit of life. We try to make it flesh and carnal, flesh and soul. And they're not. And when you live in the soul, you're self-conscious. So you are conscious of self, whereas when you live in Christ, you are Christ conscious. When you live in the Spirit, you are Christ conscious. And that is one of the tests. I mean, I remember when I was being taught. I remember I was real young, man. I mean, I was like a year-old. I remember I was a kid in the ministry, and I was a year old in the world. my spirit, I am not comfort. And in my spirit dwells this nature that is father conscious. And the potential for one human being, much less the whole world, is wrapped up in this one. Oh, right here. Let the Sabbath be every day, 365 days. Let us enter into rest. Cease from those tremendous labors. And find rest for your souls. Rest for your soul that's been doing all the work. And let Christ begin to come. But you know, there are decisions, and it takes a while at first. Decisions that were so easily made, self, without even thinking self. You don't even necessarily know their self. They've been so part of who you are. Pretty soon you go, wham, wham. Lord, what would you have me to do? Wow. And you feel, and there's nothing wrong with feeling a reaction. You feel a reaction, I don't like this, and then you go, quit. If they're wrong, that's one thing. But if my reaction is wrong, let's say the action they took was in the soul of their flesh, and now I'm reacting in my flesh, then I'm just as wrong as they are, so I ought to be mad at me. But no, I like me, and I'm mad at them. Now explain that. I'll tell you what the explanation is. My soul likes me, and my soul don't like their soul. So what you have to do is you say, no, their soul, my soul, anybody else's soul is wrong, bad, my soul is bad, anybody else's wrong. More importantly than that is, way more important is, I really want it to be Jesus. So, okay, I feel this anger, I feel upset over this situation. Now, what is the Word of God say? They just heard it. I'm going to do a legal business. Okay, I'll bless you. Let's go. I'll obey the prayer. Because I know His Spirit. I just love those who love me. Love me. If you're in the flesh, and I do have to say this, the process of doing this, I found out a lot of things, something was flesh, really goes from the Lord. And I was shooting an army too, whatever. Not every time, but I mean a lot of times it was really the Lord, and I was fighting against the Lord because I didn't understand it. Oh, I didn't understand it. So I understood this. I did it, you know, long before I received Jesus. Yeah, I did this kind of deal basically the only thing is I added Jesus ever so often. He's there, you know, because the Word of God says it too. Being there as the life, nature. That's why I say the life, I mean the nature. It's not the person of Jesus inside of you. It's not Jesus in there. You're waiting for the person of Jesus to take hold of your body, and you're looking at it wrong. He doesn't do that for you. The person of Jesus, He gave you His nature, and His nature is one of self-giving. When you have the capacity, when you know it, or believe it or not, it doesn't really matter. And that doesn't mean God doesn't love you if you don't know it. Because there's nothing. It's just been constantly working to bring you that. But nonetheless, you do have the capacity. Well, it sounded so mean. Well, in my, there's a difference between firm and mean. There is a difference. Firm is sometimes mean. Firm is sometimes mean. We have fears. We have whatever, and that's not to justify wrong or anything else. So I've done wrong. So that eventually it gets to pleasure, but still a small voice in front of your own children. Say what he wants to say, because we love you, we will receive it, stay up.